So in the last video, we built a classifier that could predict whether or not a handwritten digit was a 5 or not. And in this video, we're going to take those techniques and generalize them so that we have a neural network that can predict exactly what digit we're dealing with, not just a 5, but a 4, a 3, and so on. And along the way, we're going to learn a bunch of new techniques that are generalizable to making all neural networks work better. The perceptron algorithm, if you think about it, it's very, very constrained. It can only output a single number. So how do we take the output of a single number and turn that into a prediction for each possible digit? You might, if you feel up for it, stop the video now and think about it. Welcome back. I'm going to tell you how to do it. One way you might have thought of, which is not how we're going to do it, is just have the number be between 0 and 10 instead of 0 and 1, and basically round it down and say, okay, if it output 8.5, then that's an 8. If it outputs 7.2, then we predict the digits to 7. And for a number of reasons, that's not the normal way to do it. So we're going to actually do it a different way, which is we're going to have 10 perceptrons that run in parallel. And we're basically going to say whichever perceptron outputs the highest number, that's going to be the digit that we predict. So we basically have a perceptron responsible for classifying zeros, and then another one responsible for classifying ones, and so on. And whichever one has the highest output, that is the prediction that our whole classifier is making. Remember Rosenblatt, the perceptron inventor from the last video? This is actually the same as what he did. So he would set up multiple light bulbs corresponding to each class, and whichever light bulb lit up the brightest was considered to be the class of the image. In our case, we're going to have 10 perceptrons corresponding to each digit. And like I said, what we'd like our classifier to do is output a 1, or a number really close to 1, for the digit that was actually written in the image, and a 0 for all the other digits. And what we're specifically going to optimize for is our output being close to the target. In other words, our loss function will be the difference between each of these digits and each of these outputs that we want. So here's a quick question to kind of test your understanding. How many weights does our algorithm have now? You can stop and think about this one too, and I'll get back to it in a minute. Okay, let's go to the code. So you should be back in the video intro directory, and you should have checked out my code. Go back to the previous video if you haven't. Open up perceptron-linear.py. Now, up to line 20, everything is exactly the same as in our last tutorial. In fact, it's a little simpler because we can just use y_test as our output instead of trying to make a new variable that says if it's a 5 or not. Now, in lines 20 and 21, we need to do something called one-hot encoding our output. One-hot encoding is super common in machine learning and especially in neural networks. You basically transform your data, which is a number, into a list of ones and zeros. We take the list on the left and we turn it into the table on the right. So a 3 becomes 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Now, why do we do it? It's because we need to be explicit about what we want our network to output. Our network is going to output a list of 10 numbers, one from each perceptron. And if our label is a 3, what we really want it to do is output not a 3, but 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Okay, so lines 20 and 21 change y_train and y_test into one-hot encoded variables. What is the dimension of y_train before this transformation? It's a list of 60,000 numbers. What is the dimension of y_train after this transformation? It's a matrix with 60,000 rows and 10 columns where every entry is either a 1 or a 0. Stop the video and rewind if you need to think about this. Or you can go into the code and print out the variables and look at them. But we'll go on. We set num_classes from the shape of y_train. In this case, num_classes is 10, corresponding to 10 digits that we want to predict. Now, our model looks really similar to the model we saw in the last video. Sequential is the same. Flatten is the same. Dense now takes an input num classes instead of 1. This means that we're training 10 perceptrons, and our output will be a list of size 10 instead of 1 like it was before. Everything else is the same for now, and we can run our model. And, you know, your model may run slower or faster depending on the speed of your computer. My model gets around 16% accuracy on this run, and note that this is not deterministic, and neural networks in general are not deterministic, so you might get a somewhat different number. It's always really important when doing any kind of machine learning to think about baselines. What accuracy would random guessing get on this data set? Maybe stop and think about it. Okay, I'll tell you. There's 10 digits in our data, and our data is actually evenly distributed, so random guessing, say we guess zero every time or just random numbers, we'd get around 10% accuracy. So we can pat ourselves on the back and say that our model is doing better than random, which is actually better than our model did in the first episode of this series. So we're off to a good start, but there are a ton of ways to improve this model. And the first thing we should probably do is fix the activation function. And that's actually something we did in the last video. So remember that our target values are zeros and ones, but our weighted sum can be anything. A sigmoid or a softmax activation function will take the weighted sum and squeeze its output to a number between 0 and 1. Rosenblatt, in fact, used the same activation function with perceptrons, and it's a little unusual that we left it out. It helped us a lot in the last video, so let's add it back by setting activation equals softmax to the line where we make the perceptrons. You basically always want to use a softmax activation function on the last layer of your network if you're doing classification. And the simple reason to do this is that you want to constrain your output to be between 0 and 1. And you can see this works significantly better. Right off the bat, I'm getting around 37-38% accuracy. This is where we stopped last time, but what else can we do? Let's take another look at that loss function. So this gets a little mathy, but loss functions really matter. In this diagram, I have two linear regressions. We're used to linear regression optimizing squared error, but actually you can optimize lots of things. Here, one graph optimizes the absolute distance between the line and the points, and the other optimizes the square of the distance. Can you guess which is which? I actually do this in the prequel video, but take some time to think about it if you haven't seen this before. This surprises lots of students, but the left is actually optimizing squared error, and the right is optimizing absolute error. Squared error means that the distance to a point is squared, so further points actually have a lot more pull on the line than points closer to the line. Outliers have a big effect on squared error and much less of an effect on absolute error. Loss functions matter a lot with neural nets also. We've been using mean squared error, but when you're working with probabilities, categorical cross entropy is really the thing you want to use. Now, this is a part you can skip ahead of or just let your eyes glaze over. And the takeaway, I'll tell you, is that you should always use categorical cross entropy if you're categorizing things. But many students always want to know why is it, and I'll try to explain it without getting into too much math. Categorical cross entropy loss makes neural networks output their true probability of an outcome. So if the answer you're looking for is 1, categorical cross entropy will give you an infinite loss if you predict 0, and diminishing returns the closer you predict to 1. Remember that with a loss function, lower is better, and higher is worse. I'll tell you, I took a class at Stanford a long time ago where every question was a multiple choice question, and we had to put our probability belief of each answer, not just the answer that we thought was most likely. And we were actually scored with categorical cross entropy. If we put that we thought the probability of an answer was 0, and it turned out to be the right answer, we would get negative infinity points and fail the entire class. So we would never put a probability of 0 unless we were 100% sure it wasn't the answer. If the teacher had given us just as many points as the probability score we put on the right answer, we wouldn't have been properly incentivized, and we wouldn't have put any probability on the low probability answers. And you probably need to stop and think about that. I know I would need to stop and think about that. And if it really didn't make any sense, or if you want to think about it more later, it's totally fine. The main point, again, is that you should always use categorical cross entropy as your loss function when doing classification. Let's try it. So where it used to say MSE or mean squared error, we change it to categorical underscore cross entropy. And as you can see, this improves things quite a bit. And it's another benefit is that we can trust the output of these perceptrons to be guessed probabilities of the different digits. Okay, but we're not done yet. There's another thing that tutorials never cover that's super important to getting neural networks to work well, which is normalizing your data. So neural networks are not what's known as scale invariant. If you take your data and you divide it all by 2 or multiply it by 10, some algorithms won't change. Decision trees and random forests, they don't care about the actual magnitude of your data. But neural nets actually really do. And when you're working with Keras, or actually most of the well-known neural network libraries like TensorFlow or PyTorch, you'll get much better results if you normalize your data to be between 0 and 1 or negative 1 and 1. And actually, in our case, our data is between 0 and 255, so it's way outside of the range that our network is expecting to have the data in. Right now, all of our data is between 0 and 255, and we want it to be between 0 and 1. So let's try just adding x underscore train divide equals 255, which should divide every value in x underscore train by 255. We also do the same thing for x underscore test. We save our file and we run it. What happens? We get a really scary looking error message. It turns out that we need to cast our x underscore train and x underscore test to floats. Right now, they're set to integers. We can add x underscore train equals x underscore train dot as type float. If you're having trouble following along, the complete working code is in perceptron-normalize.py. And it turns out that this little change helps a ton. Normalizing data is a messy detail of neural networks that people just don't talk about enough. Okay, guys, we've made a ton of progress here. You'll never make this much progress this fast ever in your career, trust me. We've gone from 15% accuracy to 90% accuracy in 10 minutes. So it's worth recapping what we did. So one is we set our activation function to be softmax, which is a good idea. We set our loss function to categorical cross entropy, which is a good idea if you're doing categorization. And we normalized our data, which is almost always a good idea. But there's still actually a lot more to go. Right now, we only have a single layer of perceptrons, which is really far from deep learning. Before we go on, how many weights does our model have? Each label or output is connected to each pixel or input. And there's 784 inputs, and there's 10 outputs. So there's going to be a total of 7,840 weights in our model. And actually, I lied to you. There's a few more. Each perceptron has what's called a bias term, which is an input always set to 1. You don't really have to worry about that. But to get the exact answer, there's really 7,850 parameters for this model to learn. You can always check that by calling model.summary. In fact, let's do that quickly now. So as you can see, the flatten layer has no trainable parameters, since it always does the same thing every time. And the dense layer has 7,850 trainable parameters. Despite having all these parameters, our model can actually only look at individual correlations between a pixel and a label. If we want to capture interactions between pixels, we need to make our model more complicated. A multilayer perceptron takes the output of some number of perceptrons and uses them as input to more perceptrons. Here, the input comes in from the bottom, and there's a hidden intermediate layer. The intermediate perceptrons work just like the output perceptrons, but they don't classify anything. They just output numbers. Typically these days, hidden layers use an activation function called ReLU, or rectified linear unit, a complicated name for an unbelievably simple algorithm. It just truncates the negative values. Basically, it turns out all nonlinear activation functions work very similarly, and ReLU is just really fast and has some other benefits, so it's used for intermediate layers most of the time. Okay, you can try to modify our existing code, or you can take a look at mlp.py, where we've set this up for you. This code is super similar to our perceptron model, with really just a single important line added, and that's line 40. And what this line does is it adds a second dense layer with a number of hidden nodes. Now, we set this in config.hiddennodes to 100, but you can definitely try other numbers. Now, let's run mlp.py and see what happens. One thing you'll notice right away is that this model takes a lot longer to train, but over time, it gets better. Now, there's another issue that's more subtle but super important, which is that our accuracy now starts to get higher than our validation accuracy. In fact, if you run this model for a while, the accuracy will get a lot better and the validation accuracy will not improve. This is a phenomenon known as overfitting. As models become more complicated, overfitting becomes more and more of an issue, and it can happen in all kinds of domains, including single variable regression. Here, the line in the middle is a little more free than the straight line is on the left, but if we let our line move around too much, it can just go through all the points without really capturing the data. How do you know if you're overfitting? When your training accuracy is better than your validation accuracy. Remember that our validation accuracy is the accuracy on data that the model did not see while it was training, so the validation accuracy is a better estimate of how our model is actually going to do. Try setting the number of hidden nodes to a larger and larger number and see what happens. What happens? I'll wait. Okay, we're back. Maybe that took you an hour, if you really did it. Probably the training accuracy gets better and better, but the validation accuracy, or accuracy on data the model hasn't seen before, gets worse and worse, or at least just flattens out. As models get more and more complicated, they have the potential to do better and better, but overfitting becomes more and more of a problem. In general, overfitting is a huge problem with neural nets, but there's actually one awesome silver bullet. And that silver bullet is Dropout. Dropout is a simple, easy to explain algorithm that helps a ton. On every batch of data, we set some fraction of the inputs in a layer to zero. Why is this a good idea? You might want to stop the video and think about this for a second. The way I like to think about it is that it forces the network to learn more than one reason for every classification. Imagine a pixel in the upper left was always lit up if and only if the digit was a 7. Our network would happily learn that it only needs to look at the upper left-hand digit to decide if the handwritten number was a 7 to optimize the loss in the training data. But Dropout would force the network to learn multiple pathways for deciding if a digit is a 7, because some fraction of the time, that value would be hidden. Dropout turns off when you deploy your model or when you run your model on a held out set. It's really easy to add. You should just add dropout layers between your perceptron layers and check out what it does. Now, when we train our model, the training accuracy is actually worse than the validation accuracy. But the great thing is that our validation accuracy can keep going up as we make our model more and more complicated. A great rule of thumb is this. If your training accuracy is higher than your validation or test accuracy, you're overfitting. If you are overfitting, anything you can do to make your model fancier or more complicated is only going to hurt you. You need to stop and fix that overfitting. And the easiest way to fix overfitting is almost always to add dropout. It's typically put between every layer with free parameters. So this is probably the densest video that we're going to make, and we covered a ton of material. We covered overfitting, we covered data normalization, we covered building a multi-class perceptron and a multi-layer perceptron. But we actually still haven't squeezed out all the performance that we can out of a data set like this. And to get that final ounce of performance, we're gonna have to build a convolutional neural network. And I know you guys are excited to build a convolutional neural network, so stay tuned for the next video.
Well, guys, it's my dream to be a YouTube celebrity, and I need your help. Subscribe, that's how it works, right? Like down or up?
You should do like a box.
Or I don't know, like, yeah, we'll put a box like over there.